This material is intended for general informational purposes only and does not constitute legal advice. The law varies by jurisdiction and is constantly changing. For legal advice, you should consult a lawyer that can apply the appropriate law to the facts in your case. Aloha, I'm Coralie Chun Matayoshi, and welcome to my legal podcast, What's the Law? Each week, you will learn valuable information about various legal topics to help you get through life's ups and downs, and even when things go sideways. So stay tuned. Now with me, I have Bill Harrison. He's a criminal defense lawyer with decades of experience handling hundreds of federal, state, and felony cases, including drugs and firearms, white collars and sex crimes, money laundering, racketeering, crimes of violence, and murder. We've known each other for a very long time, ever since college. And the hardest thing about this whole podcast is going to be calling him Bill instead of Billy. Welcome. So in our last podcast, we talked about murder, the difference between first and second degree murder, what prosecutors need to prove, defenses like self-defense and insanity. And today we're going to talk about lesser crimes of manslaughter, homicide, and assault. So how are Hawaii's homicide laws broken down?
Hawaii's criminal homicide laws are broken into first degree murder, mm-hmm. second degree murder, manslaughter, and negligent homicide. And there's various differences between all of those.
What is manslaughter and how is it different from murder?
Well, both murder and manslaughter involve the unlawful killing of another person. Manslaughter is a lesser crime because it doesn't involve the element of malice like murder, mm-hmm. which is intentionally or knowingly causing a death for another person. Manslaughter is the act of recklessly causing a death for another person or intentionally causing another person to commit suicide. Or in the prosecution for murder, manslaughter may be found if the defendant was under the influence of extreme mental or emotional disturbance for which there is a reasonable explanation. We call it EMED. Mm-hmm. For example, that's a classic example of the heat of passion scenario where a husband comes home early from work, finds his wife in bed with another person, flies into a rage and beats the other person to death. Okay. The defendant in that situation may initially be charged with murder, but at trial, if he proves his actions were the result of extreme emotion or mental disturbance, which was reasonable under the circumstances, he may be convicted of manslaughter instead of murder.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know, remember that Massachusetts teen who prodded her boyfriend, wow, what a nice girlfriend, to commit suicide and get back in the car when there's carbon monoxide all in there. She got convicted of manslaughter, right?
Yes, yes. In Massachusetts, if you encourage your boyfriend to commit suicide, like she did by sending numerous texts to that person, urging him to go through with this plan. Mm-hmm. And if he does it, gets into a car full of carbon monoxide, and she doesn't call for help right. while he's dying, she is can be charged with manslaughter.
So what did the prosecutor have to show in for causation? Is it the same standard as murder where you have to show that it's a substantial cause?
Yes, yes, absolutely. There's always a causation requirement in these kinds of cases, okay? And so, you know, let's assume a person approaches a red light and instead of stopping, he quickly looks both ways and he runs a light because he's late for dinner, okay? If his actions caused him to strike a jogger in the crosswalk, for instance, thereby killing her, that would be considered manslaughter. The driver disregarded a substantial, unjustifiable risk that he would cause an accident, possibly killing someone. But in that situation, the prosecutor still has to prove the but-for of the causation in that situation, just like he would do in a murder case, okay? And so if, for instance, if the jogger is hospitalized as a result of being injured and doesn't die immediately, right? Mm-hmm. But later contracts a rare bacterial disease while they're in the hospital, which a lot of times people do, right? And then dies as a result of that infection, then the prosecutor's got to prove to the jury the reckless conduct that the person caused significantly contributed to that death, okay, that but-for situation as we do in a murder case.
Oh, okay. So what is attempted manslaughter and what is the penalty for that?
Okay. So as we talked about before, attempted manslaughter or attempted at anything, the penalty is generally the same. If I were to point a gun at someone attempting to kill them, mm-hmm. pull the trigger, and I miss that person, that's an attempt because I intended to kill them. Right. And I believed that my conduct was going to do what I expected it to do, but it did not do that.
Okay. And this penalty is the same though, right?
Penalty is the same as as you would if you actually committed the actual act.
Right. So how about defenses? What are some of the defenses to manslaughter?
And you pretty much have a lot of the same defenses that you would have in other cases, okay? Self-defense, insanity, we talked about before, parent witnessing their child being run over by a reckless driver, attacks the driver in that situation. Then the driver pulls out a handgun, parent takes the gun away, kills the driver. You may have two things there, self-defense, and you may have you know, the issue of whether the person under that is in such a rage that doesn't understand what he or she is doing. So you've got those issues that you can have similarly to a murder charge. And the same thing with mental illness. If you don't know what you're doing, you can't be held responsible for that conduct.
Mm-hmm. And if you're intoxicated, that's still not an excuse, right, in manslaughter?
No, it is not an excuse at all in manslaughter cases, as in any case, mm-hmm. because you intended to imbibe, for instance, the alcohol, intended to drink. If you intended to do that and you get drunk enough to commit a crime, there is no defense to that.
So what are the penalties for manslaughter?
Manslaughter is traditionally a Class A felony offense, which is 20 years in prison.
So how about now we talk about involuntary manslaughter, which in Hawaii is called negligent homicide. What is that?
Okay, so there's three levels of negligent homicide cases in our jurisdiction here. Okay, so first degree negligent homicide is the most serious, okay? That kind of an offense is based on intoxication, drug use. So if you were to get intoxicated and then drove your car and killed someone, you'll be charged with first degree negligent homicide because you're not supposed to be driving while intoxicated, or the alternative, while you're on the influence of drugs. Okay, so that's the most serious type of first degree homicide. Negligent homicide is that situation where drugs or alcohol are involved. Okay, and that's because you're taking a substantial and unjustifiable risk when you get into a vehicle that weighs a ton and you're under the influence. Okay, so that kind of a situation is a good example is the Kaka'ako case where the gentleman was driving around recklessly throughout Kaka'ako under the influence and killed a number of people. That's first-degree negligent homicide. Penalty, 10 years imprisonment.
Right. And isn't it also a factor that the people that he hit were vulnerable? They were pedestrians. So he had alcohol and vulnerable, which is first-degree negligent homicide, right?
Exactly. And they become vulnerable because they're standing on the sidewalk.
Right.
Yeah. So, you know, first of all, when you're in a sidewalk, you're not supposed to have a car go over the sidewalk and kill you, right? So they are very vulnerable. So you're standing by, waiting for the light to change.
Right.
That's part of the, as you say, yes, that's part of the additional factor in that case. Mm-hmm. So then we move to a second degree negligent homicide case, and that is defined as causing the death of another person while driving, not in the influence of alcohol or drugs, but in a negligent manner, okay? So let's assume two guys are racing on a busy mm-hmm. highway, and then one of them loses control of his car, crashes into another driver, and kills the driver on impact, okay? That racer could be charged with negligent homicide in the second degree if that person didn't have any alcohol or drugs in their system, just by the fact that they're driving the car in a negligent manner. And that's grossly negligent in that circumstance.
Right. And what about third degree negligent homicide?
So third degree negligent homicide is the least type of homicide, negligent homicide. And all it requires is simple negligence. And the penalty is 1 year imprisonment. So a good example of that situation is I had a client one time who was driving a Waikiki trolley. He was a trolley driver, and he was talking to a passenger. Mm-hmm. And the trolley vehicle is very high, so you can't see lower. And a woman who was crossing the crosswalk there, who was fairly short, I think she was like 5'9 or 5'10, he didn't even see her, mm-hmm. and he ran over her. Mm-hmm. In that situation, the prosecutor argued that, number one, when you're driving a vehicle like that, you have to be extra cautious when you're reaching, turning corners, you're going through crosswalks, mm-hmm. and you can't be talking to passengers and not looking out for people who may be crossing, whether they're children at 3'6" taller or, you know, adults. So you have to be careful. So that's negligent homicide in the third degree, which is a 1 year penalty. That offense actually is not charged in every jurisdiction. Hmm. A lot of jurisdictions do not charge negligent homicide in the third degree. They feel that those cases should be better handled as civil matters in a civil courtroom.
Wow.
Okay, but we have decided under the model penal code to adopt that as a criminal penalty.
Okay. So all three of these negligent homicides are acts done by a car. I mean, that's a vehicular homicide.
That's right. They're vehicular homicide. Yes, absolutely.
So what if you try to run over somebody because of road rage and the person is killed? Is that manslaughter or murder?
Okay. That would be initially charged as murder. Okay. So because you intentionally and knowingly ran the person over,
right,
and the person died. So we start with that premise like we talked about before. The fact that you were involved in road rage may in fact depends, because you got to remember that it's based on a reasonable person standard. So if your road rage was caused by something that the jury determines to be reasonable, then you possibly could have that charge reduced to manslaughter as a emotional disturbance type of a situation. But technically, it's a murder because you intentionally tried to kill that person, right? Mm-hmm. Now, if we go in the same scenario as we talked about before, where you catch your wife in bed with someone and you try to run over the guy that you caught and your wife in bed with, then yeah, you might be, you know, guilty of a manslaughter versus murder based on your emotional state.
Right. Okay. So we hear about assault and battery cases used in charging violent acts. How are these terms defined in Hawaii law?
Okay, so we don't have a battery act in Hawaii, okay? We have assault only. And there are three degrees or classes of assault. So the most serious assault is assault in the first degree. And that requires that you have to have severe injuries, okay? So first degree assault requires a person to intentionally, again, knowingly, cause serious bodily injury to another person. Serious bodily injury means injury that creates a substantial risk of death, or which causes serious permanent disfigurement or a protracted loss of impairment of a function of a body or an organ. And the penalty for that is 10 years imprisonment.
Okay.
So that's the most serious assault. Right. Assault in the second degree is less serious based on the fact that all that is required is substantial bodily injury. Same thing, knowingly, intentionally, but the degree of injury is less in that situation. And that requires substantial bodily injury is a major abrasion, laceration, penetration of the skin, a burn of second degree severity, a bone fracture, serious concussion, tearing or rupturing or corrosive damage to esophagus, viscera, or other internal organs. That's substantial bodily injury, and that's a lesser degree. And then finally, you have the situation in the second degree is if the injury is caused by a dangerous instrument, okay? Any dangerous instrument increases, even if it's a lesser injury, such as if you hit someone with, for instance, a sword, okay? The sword is dull and doesn't chop off the guy's armor, and that, but it hurts the person. In that situation, you could be charged with substantial bodily injury in terms of there's an attempt there at what you're trying to do, right? And so, with a dangerous instrument, it increases the nature of the charge. And then finally, you have a situation where you have assault in the third degree, which is the last and the most minor of these charges. And that's based on not intentional and knowingly, but recklessly causing bodily injury. And it's any bodily injury. That's the lowest. Actually, you can cause it by intentionally and knowingly doing it as well. But the nature of the injury is such that it's minimal. And all you need to have in bodily injury is physical pain or illness of any impairment of your physical condition. So if you say, ouch, when the guy hits you, that's assault in the third degree, believe it or not. If you feel pain, and levels of pain can be felt differently. So a big brute may not feel pain if you slap the person, but someone who's very slight, if you slap them, they would feel pain. So, you know, that's the situation. That would be assault in the third degree.
Okay, well, that's a wrap. We want to thank Billy Harrison for his time and expertise. And thank you for joining us on What's the Law. Until next time, ahui ho.